Welcome everyone. In today's lecture, we will discuss the next topic, that is fisheries, right? So in the introduction classes itself, we studied what is fisheries and how is fisheries different from pisciculture, if you recollect the content. What is fisheries? Tell me. Fisheries, it is a branch which deals with cultivation of fishes also. Along with fishes, shellfishes are also cultivated and even crustaceans are cultivated. So we can tell fisheries, it is an industry where we catch the fish, we process, we rear the fish and we sell the fish. Only fishes are, along with fishes, other things also na. So catching, processing and selling of fishes, shellfishes like lobsters and all which comes under mollusks, and crustaceans like prawns and crabs, everything together is called as fisheries. And in NCERT they have asked us identify the differences between aquaculture and pisciculture. We understood that fisheries means it is cultivation of fishes, shellfishes and crustaceans, whereas pisciculture means it's cultivation of only fishes, right? So what is pisciculture? Pisciculture is cultivation or production or rearing of fishes in small tanks and ponds. If we rear the fishes in small tanks and small ponds, only fishes, that is called pisciculture. Whereas cultivating many, polyculture, fishes also, shellfish also, crustaceans also, is called as fisheries. And then what is aquaculture? Aquaculture means it is production or rearing all types of plants and animals, cultivation of all types of aquatic organisms in the water bodies is called as aquaculture. Again, what is aquaculture? It is cultivation of all aquatic plants and animals in natural water bodies is called as aquaculture. Now, since it is a natural water body, so they don't depend upon us to add the feed and all to control and maintain. So very little amount of feed is required as it is a natural body. So we need not provide specifically food and supplements and all, we need not provide for the growth of the organisms, aquatic organisms there. Whereas in pisciculture, for the cultivation of fish, we need to add fish feed from outside, we need to buy and we have to add fish feed, that's called as pisciculture. The next one, many economic important substances can be obtained. Since here there are so many types of plants and animals growing in aquaculture, so many products can be obtained here through aquaculture. Whereas in pisciculture, since we are cultivating only fish, purely fish, so here we get only fishes. When we harvest pisciculture, we get only fish, which is used as a source of food, right? So in NCERT they asked us to find out the differences between aquaculture and pisciculture. Children, these are the differences between aquaculture and pisciculture. And now we also understood how is pisciculture different from fisheries also. Now we see like inland fisheries and marine fisheries. Let us try to understand what is inland fisheries and what is marine fisheries. Inland fisheries means cultivation of fishes in freshwater bodies. Inland fisheries means cultivation of fishes in freshwater is called as inland fisheries. In freshwater, usually bony fishes are getting cultivated, right? So inland fisheries means it is cultivation of freshwater fishes. Freshwater fishes, you can again divide up them into capture fisheries and culture fisheries. Capture fisheries means in rivers and in lakes already fishes will be there. Now if the fisherman goes in the rainy season and if they catch the fish and they bring it to the market and if they sell it, that comes under capture fisheries. From the areas where already river water is there, in the rainy season when fish breeding is more, from there when they capture the fishes, they sell it, that's called capture fisheries. Whereas in the land, if we are making a pond or if we are making tanks, fish tanks, prawn tanks, and then in that area if you are controlling, under controlled conditions if you are rearing fishes, that comes under cultured fisheries. Fisheries, we are telling inland fisheries and marine fisheries. Inland fisheries means cultivation of freshwater fishes. Freshwater fishes means mostly they are bony fishes. Now if they are collected from the natural rivers and lakes, then that is called capture fisheries. If they are grown under cultured conditions like ponds and tanks, that is cultured fisheries, right children? Now the common freshwater fishes, this is important. So many times questions came in NEET examination. Identify the freshwater fish, identify the marine water fish, or eliminate the oddmen out. So we need to remember the examples. In NCERT, three examples are mentioned under freshwater fishes, four examples have mentioned under marine water fishes. Let us see what examples they are. Under freshwater fishes, NCERT has quoted about one name called Rohu, another name called Katla, the third one is common carp. NCERT says the freshwater fishes examples are Rohu, Katla and common carp. Scientific name of Rohu, Lebio rohita. Scientific name of Katla is Katla katla. Scientific name of common carp, it's called as Picinus carpio. Scientific name of common carp, children, it's called Picinus carpio. Katla scientific name, Katla katla. Rohu scientific name, Lebio rohita. These three are examples of inland fishes, freshwater fishes. Now coming to the second one, marine fisheries. Marine fishes means cultivation of marine fishes. Marine fisheries means cultivation of marine fishes. Usually in marine water, cartilaginous fishes, right? Osteichthyes, cartilaginous fishes will be there. So that comes under marine fisheries. And I told you in NCERT, four examples have been mentioned for cultivation of marine fisheries. One is Hilsa, second one is sardine, third one is mackerel, and fourth one is pomfrets. What are the four examples which comes under marine water fishes? One is Hilsa, second one is sardine, third one is mackerel, and fourth one is pomfrets. If we have to find out the scientific names of Hilsa, it is Tenulosa ilicia. Tenulosa ilicia is the scientific name of Hilsa. Sardine, common name as well as scientific name is the same, sardine only. Whereas mackerels are a group of fishes which are thin, tiny, thin. Okay, so they are long and thin fishes. They're long fishes. Then we call that group of marine water fishes as mackerels. They belong to a family here. It is Scomberidae. So they belong to a family, Scomberidae, and they are thin and long fishes. The last one is pomfrets. Again, this also a group of fishes which are having a such a type of structure. They belong to family Bramidae. So pomfrets belong to family Bramidae. Such type of fishes come under pomfrets. Mackerels, they are thin and long fishes. They are a group of fishes which belong to family called Scrombidae. So Hilsa, sardine, pomfrets, mackerels come under marine fishes. Katla, Rohu, common carp come under freshwater fishes. And brackish water, what do you mean by brackish water? The water where the freshwater bodies mixes into the saline water bodies, means there the salt concentration will be variable. Since the freshwater is going and merging up into the marine water bodies, that junction point is called as brackish water bodies. In brackish water also certain type of fishes will be cultivated. Understood children? What did we see on this board? Our today's topic is fisheries. We have seen the definition of fisheries. NCERT says fisheries means it is an industry which is devoted to catching, cultivation and selling of fishes along with fishes, shellfishes and crustaceans, and aquaculture, pisciculture differences, inland fisheries and marine fisheries differences. Take a screenshot, we will continue. Right, now have you heard of green revolution? Yes, right, green revolution is production of food, means improving technologies where we can produce like more amount of agricultural crops. Now have you heard of white revolution? White revolution is related to milk production. Green revolution is related to agricultural production. White revolution is related to milk production. Like that, what is blue revolution? So in blue revolution we use certain techniques where we improve the fish production. What is blue revolution? Blue revolution has increased the growth and production of fish and marine products, right? Blue revolution is same as green revolution. right? In Green Revolution, we talked about Swaminathan. M.S. Swaminathan is father of Green Revolution in India. And after independence, the main problem what Indians faced is scarcity. Like there's no proper food and people are dying because of hunger. So then Swaminathan introduced chemical farming, pesticides, insecticides, fertilizers and all to improve the yield, right? So he enhanced the production by 3 times or 4 times. So that production is because of Green Revolution, we tell. In the same manner, in Blue Revolution, we include certain techniques and processes which cause significant growth in the production of fishes. So in Blue Revolution, techniques and processes are involved. Techniques and processes are involved, so which will cause significant growth in the production of fish, which causes significant growth, right? Which causes significant growth in production of fishes and fish products. So this is called as Blue Revolution. Now it brought too much of amount of economy. It increased our income, it increased employment, right? It brought a lot of income to the farmers and fishermen. This Blue Revolution, we can tell Blue Revolution, so brought lot of income. It brought lot of income to farmers and fishermen as well, right? And India, with so many coastal areas, so fisheries is one of the thing where we can use and we can get economy, right? India with many coastal areas, fisheries have an important role to increase our Indian economy, right? So we can write that point also. India with many coastal areas. Since India has many coastal areas, fisheries will play an important role in Indian economy. Fisheries will play an important role in Indian economy, right, children? So we can improve the Indian economy if we start using new methods and start developing more number of fishes. So through the technology called Blue Revolution. Now when we talk about fish, so fish belongs to which class or which super class? Tell me it belongs to which class or it belongs to which super class. Now we can tell fishes are aquatic or terrestrial. They are aquatic. They are cold-blooded, warm-blooded, they are poikiothermic, they are cold-blooded animals. They are cold-blooded animals, they are aquatic, they are cold-blooded animals, and they come under vertebrates or non-vertebrates. They are vertebrates. They are vertebrates and they belong to a super class called Pisces, right? So they belong to super class. Children, what is the super class called? The super class is called Pisces. Now the classes, Pisces super class is divided into two classes. One is bony fishes. The other one is cartilage fishes. So these two are classes and Pisces comes under super class, right? And vertebrata is the subdivision. We can tell that fishes are aquatic, they are cold-blooded animals, they are vertebrates, they belong to a super class called Pisces. Under that there are two classes. What are the two classes? The two classes are bony fishes and cartilage fishes, and they come under the phylum called Chordata. Fishes belong to phylum called Chordata, right, children? So what we did talk in this board, we were talking about Blue Revolution. What is Blue Revolution? We are telling Blue Revolution is similar to Green Revolution, where we have employed many techniques and many tools to improve the food production, agricultural yield. In the same manner, in Blue Revolution also, we have employed many tools and techniques and processes where we can improve the growth of the fish and other marine products. That's called as Blue Revolution. revolution. And if you see, the blue revolution has brought lot of income to the farmers also and fishermen also. It has created employment also. Now India, which is having many coastal areas, water bodies, now fisheries, if we improve, so our Indian economy will increase. And coming to fishes, if we see the terrestrial or aquatic animals, they are aquatic animals, warm-blooded or cold-blooded, they are cold-blooded. Vertebrates or non-vertebrates, they are vertebrates. And to which class they belong to? They belong to either bony fishes or cartilage fishes class, and their super class is Pisces, and they belong to phylum Chordata. So, and then if we are rearing the fishes, what are the stages we can find? First we will tell egg. The egg will hatch, right? When the egg hatches, when the fish egg hatches, it is called as hatchling. And after hatchling, the small one, which is this much, is called 1 or 2 inches. It's called as fries. After egg, when it hatches, it becomes hatchling. After that, it is called as fries. After the fries, they'll be of a finger size. They're called as fingerlings. After fries, the next development stage is fingerlings. After fingerlings, they become adult fish. Then they become adult fish. So these are the stages in their growth. First egg will hatch, and that's called hatchling. After that, it'll become a small 1 or 2 inches small fish, which is called as fries. After that, they get to the size of the finger. They are called as fingerlings. Then they are called as adult fishes. Now eggs and hatchlings, where are they kept? They are kept in certain type of specific ponds, which are called as nursery ponds. Eggs and hatchlings, they are kept in nursery ponds, whereas the fries and fingerlings, they are kept in rearing ponds. The fries and fingerlings, from hatchling stage, when it's going to the fry stage, then we transfer it into another pond. What is it called? Rearing pond. This is called rearing pond. And once it becomes adult, the rest of the life it will lead another pond, which is called stocking pond. From the stocking pond only they'll catch it and they'll take it to the market. So adult fish will be in stocking pond, right children? So these are the stages of the development, and these are the places where they are reared. Egg and hatchlings are reared in the nursery ponds, fries and fingerlings are reared in the rearing ponds, and adult is reared in the stocking pond. All about fisheries we discussed. Now finally, let us discuss about the economic importance of fishes also, right? Take a screenshot, then we will talk about the economic importance of fishes. Right, so now let us see, like, what is the economic importance of fishes? As we already discussed, right, it's a source of economy, right? So fishermen and all, they bring the fish to the market and they sell it. And why do we buy it? So non-vegetarians, right, fisherians, eggarians, like that, we can tell fisherians who eat fish. So why do they eat it? Because fish is rich in proteins. When we have to talk about economic importance, we'll tell the first point we can tell, fish is rich in proteins, and that too, those fish proteins are rich of essential amino acids. And if we take meat, that meat is also rich in protein only, but along with the protein, it has fat also. But fish, it has very much amount of protein, but the fat content will be very less. And the little amount of fat which is there in the fish, it is rich in omega-3 fatty acids, which is very good for the heart. So we can tell fish is an excellent source of protein. Fish is an excellent source of protein. And which type of protein it is? Containing all the essential amino acids. These proteins contain, what do they contain, children? They contain all the essential amino acids which are required for the body. All the essential amino acids, and with little fat. Protein will be enormous, but the fat, fish fat is very less. And this fat is rich in omega-3 fatty acids. This fat which is present in fish is rich in, what is that? Omega-3 fatty acids. Omega-3 fatty acids are very good for heart. omega 3 fatty acids are very good for heart. So this is one significance of fish. Not only that, we tell that fish are excellent sources of micronutrients also, like vitamins and minerals. So fish is a source of fat soluble vitamins like A and D, and minerals like iodine and all. So these are macronutrients, proteins and fat. So our next point will be, fish is also an important source of micronutrients. What do you mean by micronutrients? Micronutrients means vitamins and minerals. Vitamins and minerals. Which vitamins, particularly which vitamins are found in fish? Means vitamin A and vitamin D. So we can tell vitamin A rich source is fat, fish, and vitamin D rich source is also fish. Minerals, particularly iodine, is present in fish. So this is another economic importance about the fishes. They are rich in macronutrients also, they are rich in micronutrients also. And the liver of marine fishes, from which we extract fish liver oil, shark liver oil, cod liver oil, right? So then again, this liver oil is rich again in the fat soluble vitamins like A and D. So we can tell, so from the liver of marine fishes, from the liver of marine fishes, it's not that from freshwater fishes we cannot extract liver oil, from there also we can extract, but in bulk quantities we can extract from the marine fishes. From the liver of marine fishes we extract fish liver oil. So what is this fish liver oil? Fish liver oil is excellent source. It is excellent source of vitamin A and D. So we can take examples of shark liver oil, cod liver oil, right? These are some examples. These are some examples. And after extracting the oil from this liver, the waste material is called as fish, it's called as fish manure. The waste material, after extracting, it becomes like a fish cake, right? A dried material. What is it called? That's called fish manure. And this fish manure is used as a fertilizer. So the left out material, the left out material after liver oil extraction, after we extract the liver oil from the liver, the left out material acts as a fish manure. It is used as biofertilizer. What is it called? This is called fish manure, and it is used as a fertilizer. Not only this, we can tell, like when the fish is getting processed, all the waste of the fish, small pieces and all, head and tail, all these things will be dried off, and this dried material, which is also rich source of protein, it is used for feeding the chicks. Means it is used as a feed in poultry industry. We can tell the fish pieces, right? The fish pieces or the fish wastes, so they are dried. Fish pieces and fish waste, they are dried, and it is used as a feed in poultry industry. It is used as a feed for feeding the chicken in poultry industry, because that is also rich source of protein, right? And another thing we can mention here is, like, fish glue, they will tell. Fish glue, some gelatin like substance will be there. Fish glue is extracted from cod fish. From which fish do we extract this? It is called cod fish. We extract fish glue, which is very much sticky, and for binding the books and all, fat books and all, the gum what they use is this gum. What is it called? Fish glue. And the last importance we can tell, it is isinglass. What is it called? It is isinglass. Yeah, it is a syngas. Now we tell that bony fishes have air bladder. Because of the air bladder, they maintain their buoyancy, so they need not swim continuously. They can stay above the surface of the water. We'll tell in the same manner. We'll tell cartilaginous fishes, since they don't have air bladder, in order to maintain buoyancy, they have to constantly swim. If not, they will fall down. They'll shrink to the bottom. We will tell. So I'm talking about air bladder, which is absent in cartilage fishes, which is present in bony fishes. From this air bladder, they extract a gelatinous substance which is called as isinglass. So from the air bladder, they extract, means from bony fishes only, they extract a material which is called as isinglass. This is gelatinous material. It is used in certain cement preparations, and it is used in processing of wine. Isinglass, which is prepared from, where are we preparing? It is prepared from the air bladder. It is prepared from the air bladder. What it is? It is a gelatinous substance. It is a gelatinous substance, and it is used in preparation of, we use this isinglass in preparation of some types of cements. Some cement. And it is also used in processing of wine. It is also used in processing of wine. So children, this is economic importance of fisheries and fish. The main function is, it is a rich source of protein. The protein which is present in fish is rich in essential amino acids, and it has very little fat, and that fat is also good fat, as it contains omega-3 fatty acids. And then we are telling, not only macronutrients, it is rich source of micronutrients also, like vitamins and minerals. Which vitamins? Fat soluble vitamins like A and D. Rich sources are fish liver oil, cod liver oil. Which mineral fish can provide, means iodine. Then we are telling, from the liver of marine fishes, we extract oil called fish liver oil, cod liver oil, which is excellent source of vitamin A and D. Now after we extract the oil, whatever the liver paste is there, that we dry it and we use it as a fish manure. This fish manure acts as a fertilizer. Then when we are processing the fish, the head, tail and small pieces, they are dried and they used as feed in poultry farming. Then fish glue, extracted from codfish, it is sticky and it is used for binding bigger books. Next one is isinglass. Isinglass is extracted from the air bladder of bony fishes. It's a gelatinous substance. It is used in certain types of cements, and it is used in processing of the wine. So with this, we completed animal husbandry, where we discussed about dairy farm management, poultry farm management, beekeeping also we discussed, and fisheries also we discussed. In the next class, we'll start the botany topics, that is plant breeding. If the lectures are informative, like, share, subscribe to my channel. Thank you.